And now hear the word of the Lord. First of all, from Psalm 146, verse 5, happy is he who has the God of Jacob for his help, whose hope is in the Lord his God. And then from Jeremiah, the 17th chapter, verses 7 and 8, blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose hope is the Lord. For he shall be like a tree planted by the waters, which spreads out its roots by the river, and will not fear when heat comes, but her leaf will be green, and will not be anxious in the year of drought, nor will cease from yielding fruit. And then Paul in Romans 12, verse 12, rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing steadfastly in prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God of hope, we ask you to give us the hope that will radiate as happiness upon our faces. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Several weeks ago, I had a prayer time with the pastors in the robing room before coming in to the chancel to begin the service. It was one of those times that we were all taking ourselves very seriously and probably needed to take God much more seriously than ourselves. And George Hendrickson, with his customary good humor, said, have you heard the story? A woman came into church, and she went into the narthex and said to the usher, how long has Lloyd Ogilvie been preaching? And the usher said, oh, about 35 years. And then she looked through the window into the sanctuary and up to the pulpit, and I was preaching away. And she said, oh, then, he should be finished pretty soon, shouldn't he? I wonder if I may add just a few minutes to those 35 years and tell you about a happy God who is the author of authentic, lasting happiness. My granddaughters, Erin and Erly, are very happy children. Well, most of the time. Probably the only exception I know about is family photograph time. You know, we do test the patience of children. We rearrange their dresses and try and get the camera just right and all of the lights perfect. And they get a little bit impatient in the midst of that. I don't blame them. But their mother, Eileen, has discovered that there is a special click word that gives them the clue that it's time to turn on the happy face to clap and clown around a little bit. Well, the result is that Mary Jane and I, who are affectionately called Papa and Mama, have albums full of pictures of impish, laughing, full of fun, life-affirming children. All Eileen has to do is say, happy, and the kids go into action. Now, if I were to say to you, happy, what would happen? Some of you would say, wait a minute. I don't feel happy. You can't push me or manipulate me into giving a happy face. Often we say to one another, please be happy, as if we could put on a jolly mask and start smiling until our teeth get dry. That's hard when you don't feel like it inside. A man said to his wife when they were beginning a week's vacation, as they drove away from their house, he turned to her and said, listen, dear, this is our vacation, and I want you to be happy the whole week. But she tried her best. You know, she tried to be happy and full of fun. But when she got home, she crashed. Some unfinished business had not been taken care of. Some broken things inside of her, and especially her relationship with her husband was such that a mere interlude of factitious happiness didn't last. I remember after I married a couple once, I overheard the father of the bride say to the bride and the groom some very stern and imperious words. He got the two of them off together, happy kids. But he wanted to be sure, and he said, "Listen, kids, your mother and I have worked years to get to the place where we are, and all the stuff we've given you is to make you happy. Your house, your car, and everything else is to make you the happiest couple that ever got married. Now, I want you to go off on your honeymoon, and when you come back, I want to see that you're happy." Well, pretty hard to be happy on cue like that, isn't it? And it just so happens that couple had to discover happiness in a much more profound way than that father dictated. Talk to a friend who's been going through some very hard times. And by God's grace, those hard times have come to an end. He now looks back on them. But a friend said to the man, "Now you have a hope for happiness." He came to see me and he said, "Lloyd, I've gotten so used to being unhappy that I find it very hard to be happy." He said, "Hard times conditioned me to be unhappy, and I can't turn it on. What do you do about that?" Well, you know, that statement made to him, "Now you have a hope for happiness," was both untrue and true. It was untrue that happiness would now be his because the bad things were behind him. But more profound than that, there is a direct interrelationship between hope and happiness. And that's what I want to talk about. I asked you the question, are you happy? Really? If not, why not? And if so, will it last? I want to talk to you about a happy God who gives us lasting happiness. Point one, true happiness is the result of knowing that you're blessed. That's what the psalmist expressed when in the 146th Psalm, he said, "Happy is he who has the God of Jacob for his help, whose hope is in the Lord his God." Now, we all know that the Psalms sometimes refer to the God of Jacob as the God of Israel or Judah. But I wonder if something more profound isn't implied. Happy is the one who has the God of Jacob for his God. What do we know about the God of Jacob? Not only the patriarch's God, not only the historical God, but the God who did something very special in the life of Jacob. You remember, Jacob was a twin with Esau. And the one thing Jacob longed for most was Isaac's blessing. Now, the blessing in the Old Testament was the very special gift of the father or the parents, indicating to a child that he or she was accepted and cared for and affirmed. Now, Jacob knew that the birthright was to go to his brother. And he longed for that birthright, but his deepest longing was for his father's blessing. He spent most of his life yearning for it, and even when he stole the birthright, he still felt unblessed. Many people know what that's like. Many have lived in families where they were not blessed. Many have never felt the father's approbation, the mother's tender confirmation. Many spend their whole lives longing for someone to bless them. And as a result, they're unhappy. And I believe that this is one of the reasons that we chuck our lives full of material possessions, hoping that somehow, something, some comfort, some acquirement will give us happiness. It's interesting that when Thomas Jefferson wrote about our inalienable rights, he said that we have a right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Now, those of you who know your John Locke know that Thomas Jefferson lifted that sentence right out of John Locke. Only John Locke put it that we have an inalienable right to life, liberty, and property. I wonder if Jefferson had in mind that having property fulfilled the pursuit of happiness. Whether or not, this is one nation where we believe that happiness is inseparably related to what we possess. And if we can drive it and park it and say it's ours, it may be a BMW, but our lives may be SAD. Or it may be a magnificent house, but it might be an empty heart inside of it. Happiness just is not the result of what we possess. But those who feel unblessed have to somehow get those things which say to them, I am worth something. And you remember the story of Jacob. He spent his whole life searching for that. And only later at Peniel, when he wrestled with the presence of God and said, I will not let you go until you bless me, that the living God gave him what he had searched for all of his life, and he knew that he was blessed. Jacob means supplanter, for he came out after his brother Esau. He was born out of Rebekah's womb as a twin, hanging on to the foot of his brother. It means heel catcher. And the Lord blessed him and gave him a new name, Israel, which means God strives. Jacob had been striving to achieve status, was given status with God that made it no longer necessary to strive for security. Happiness for you and for me is knowing that we've been blessed by God, that we're the blessed child in the family of God. And then we discover that everyone else is also. And we begin to share that love with others with winsomeness and freedom. There's no happiness until you have that inner security of being affirmed and loved and assured that the Lord knows. But more than that, more than simply knowing that we're blessed, happiness is putting your roots down into the flow of the blessing. And that's what's expressed in this 17th chapter of Jeremiah, when the prophet distinguishes in a very dynamic dialectic between the shrub in the desert and the tree planted by the waters, by the river. What a vivid picture. Can't you see that scrawny, dried up, burned up scrub out in the dry and thirsty land of the desert? Now look at the tree next to the river. Jeremiah says, blessed, happy, for that's what the word blessed means throughout Scripture in both the Hebrew and the Greek. Happy is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose hope is in his Lord. And then he goes on to say, for he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. he will be a person who presses out his roots to the river. There's a very active word here in the Hebrew. Presses down deep into the soil, pushes over toward the river until it can suck up the fullness of the blessing of the river. You see, the river of the flow of the power of God is one of the central symbols of both the Old and the New Testament. Ezekiel had a vision of the flowing of the river of God. And in that 47th chapter of Ezekiel, he says, "And everywhere the river goes, there shall be life. Everything that the river touches shall come alive." And then that marvelous 46th psalm, "There is a river that makes glad the city of God." The river of the flow of the Spirit of God is the source of the experience of the blessing of God. And when we put our roots deep down into Him, then there's a flow of the experience of grace, which then issues in joy, which is expressed outwardly in happiness. Now, I want to suggest to you that you can be happy all of the time. Now, that may sound like kind of a glib promise. It's not. It's the promise of Scripture. When Paul referred to God in the 11th verse of the first chapter of 1 Timothy, he talked about Him as a happy God, the glorious gospel of the happy God. Is it happy in heaven? Yes. Why? Because they're singing and glorifying God around the throne. His happiness is shared with the people of heaven, and they want to share it with us. To be a Christian is to begin heaven right now. And it's to know the fullness of the happy God manifesting His grace in us, which then bursts out in joy, which then captivates our countenance with happiness. Now, I want to be very personal with you and ask you a further question. May I do that? Are you the happiest person in your family, among your friends? Would the people around you say, "Now, there is a happy person"? One of the greatest ways to witness to our faith is to be filled with the happy God and have a quality of happiness that isn't dependent upon the circumstances around us, the people who do or do not love us, the desires that are or are not fulfilled, but the power of the Spirit of the living God who lives in us. And when that's written upon our faces, it's contagious. Everyone wants it. Are you finding the happiness you've always wanted? It's not available in any place or thing. It's available in God, in and through Jesus Christ our Lord. It's receiving Him as the absolute sovereign of our lives, turning the control of our lives over to Him, inviting Him to live in us. It's putting our roots down into the river of His Spirit. And that means more than a flippant prayer at the beginning of the day or to close the day. It means taking time with Him and saying, "Lord, we're living in a world, in a nation, at a time when everyone is confused about happiness. Everyone wants it. Nobody's got it. And I pray, Lord, that You grant me the privilege of being so filled with You that the world around me will know what it means to be happy."